Floods planning and management for disaster. Now, flood is a very common disaster, specifically in the area where we are living. Flood is now a common reason, a common phenomena, which actually occurs because of the heavy rainfall in our area. There are, of course, many other reasons as well. But when we talk of our area, the main reason behind the flood is the heavy rainfall and mismanagement of water. What happens is we have a lot of water. If we talk about our own city, Mumbai, we receive lot amount of water in the rainy season, which will suffice the requirement of the whole population. But what happens is there is no proper management of that rainfall water. Much of the rainfall water gets wasted, gets flooded, okay, and then creates a disaster situation. There is no proper collection, no proper management of that water, which will be useful for people and will not cause flood. Okay, so disaster is a natural or human caused phenomena which causes serious disruption of the functioning of a community or a society, causing widespread human, material, economic, and environmental losses, which elicited, that is, which exceeds the ability of the affected community or the society to cope using its own resources. So this definition, we had seen it in the previous lectures also, that what is disaster? Okay, natural or human caused phenomena which causes serious disruption of the functioning of a community or a society, causing widespread human, material, and economic and environmental losses, which exceeds the ability, the capacity of the affected community or the affected society to cope using its own resources. Of course, it requires help from the outside, unaffected people, from the response relief people, in order to deal with such situations. So that situation is called the disaster. Floods are a common feature in the country that occur every year in many parts, including South India. Flood is very a common disaster that occurs throughout our country. So floods are natural phenomena and floods are water-related disaster. So that we know. Opposite to flood is what? Opposite to flood is what is a drought. When there is no rainfall, when there is no water availability in a particular area, that situation is called the drought. Okay, so floods are opposite to that. Then, a flood occurs when the geomorphic equilibrium, the landscape, geomorphic in the sense the landscape, how the structure of the land is, okay. So that geomorphic equilibrium in the river system is disturbed because of the intrinsic or extrinsic factors. Intrinsic in the sense that could be any internal factors, or extrinsic, or can be any external factor that would change the equilibrium of the river system, or when a system crosses the geomorphic threshold. Now see here, A and B, the two diagrams given here. So the first is flooding in a river due to aggradation of river bed, which is called the intrinsic threshold. So there is some internal factor inside the river which is going to cause flooding. So what is that internal factor? The river bed aggradation. In the sense, when there is silting, when there is accumulation of this sand or silt at the bottom of the river bed, so obviously, the height of the river, the depth of the river, I mean, will reduce. Okay, so this is a natural phenomena. This is not done by human, or it occurs naturally. If silting occurs in a river bed, if there is this river bed aggradation, the depth of the river decreasing. Okay, so that is a natural phenomena, and because of which the quantity of the water that the river can hold will reduce. Correct. And therefore, the amount of water will escape outside the river, causing flooding. So that could be an intrinsic, some internal factor, some internal phenomena happening inside the river. Okay, so that is one of the reason for flooding. Sorry. And the next reason, see, flooding in a river due to heavy rainfall. So that is extrinsic factor, some external factor. It is not something that is happening inside the river, correct? So you can see here the river with its full depth, okay? And what happens is this is the level of the river which is maintained actually depth. And when there is heavy rainfall, external factor, heavy rainfall, which exceeds the capacity of the river to hold that water, of course, then flooding will occur. So that is one of the external factor, that is heavy rainfall. Okay, then floods in major cities, especially during rainy season, are proving to be disastrous not only to the environment but also have serious implications for human life and property. Okay, so you know, you might have experience also. Many people, many students, many people have experienced this, that how during the rainy season our city gets completely flooded with water and causing such disastrous effect on human life and property. Then there are different types of floods. So those are flash floods, river floods, coastal floods, and urban floods. So according to the duration also, the flood could be divided into different categories, such as slow onset floods. That is, slow onset floods usually last for a relatively longer period. It may last for one or more weeks or even months. So that is called the slow onset flood. Rapid onset flood. So the onset flood, okay, rapid onset flood lasts for a relatively shorter period, usually 1 to 2 days only. Okay, and then you have flash floods. So what is flash floods? It occur for few minutes or few hours after heavy rainfall or in some tropical storm or some failure of dam or levees. Levees is a small structure to obstruct the water, and it causes greatest damage to the society. Okay, so that is the three categories of the flood depending upon the duration of the flood. If it lasts for longer period, weeks or months, that is called the slow onset flood. If it lasts for 1 or 2 days only, that is called the rapid onset flood. And flash flood, that is for few hours or few minutes if it occur, which usually occurs in our area when there is heavy rainfall. Okay, heavy rainfall is the reason in our area. The other reason could be tropical storm, the failure of the dam or the levees, which can cause immediate flooding of the water in the city. So that is called the flash flood, correct? So then what are the different causes of flood? So from here, this table, you can find out the different causes of the flood. Just a second. There are different factors which lead to cause of flood. Could be natural factors, could be man-made factors, correct? So, causes, what leads to flooding? So, first is silting of the riverbed. Now, silting of the riverbed, like I said you in the first slide, which occurs basically because of the natural reasons, but still there could be man-made reasons also which can lead to silting of the riverbed. For example, the silting of the riverbed is one of the causes. But what are the natural factors which lead to this cause? Due to the bank erosion, earthquake loosening the soil, okay, man-made factor responsible for it, that is due to the dam embankments or bunds, okay, if that are constructed over that particular area, that can also lead to silting of the riverbed and decreasing the depth of the river. Then another cause of the flood is inadequate capacity within the bank. Okay, within the river bank, it is not capable enough to hold that much amount of water. So what could be the natural factor responsible for this? High runoff or rise in the water level, silting of the riverbed due to bank erosion. Now, in the first slide itself, I told you, if there is silting, capacity of the river to hold that water will be less. So silting is also one of the reasons for inadequate capacity. And another reason is high runoff or rise of water level. The amount of water flowing from that area exceeds, I mean, it's higher. Say at such point, at one point of time, at some time of the year, the runoff, that is the running of the water, it is running with high quantity. Okay, so that will also exceed the capacity of the river bank. Then what could be the man-made factor? High discharge from the river due to silting. So like I just told you, silting can happen due to man-made factor also, because of which the capacity of the river would reduce, and decrease in the bank height by deforestation. Okay, so as you know, the near the river bank, if there are trees, they will hold that soil, correct? But if the deforestation is done, if there are no trees near the river bank, that soil will get loosened due to say runoff, due to say wind. That soil will get eroded, it will get flown off, okay? And that will reduce the depth of the river, because it will decrease the height of the bank. Okay, so that could be deforestation, could be one of the man-made factor responsible for it. Okay, see, river bank erosion, just now it's all related. It's all related, river bank erosion. Just now I told you. And one man-made factor, if you see first, decrease in the vegetative cover due to deforestation and construction activities in the river bed. Correct? So that leads to the river bank erosion. And high discharge of water due to rain, shifting of the river courses, all these also are the factors responsible for river bank erosion. But these are the natural factors. Okay? Then, flow obstruction and change in the river course, the way the river is moving, okay, that way is change and obstruction. If suppose any obstruction to the river occurs, of course it will lead to flooding, okay. But what are the reasons for it? Landslide, falling of the trees, which are natural factors. For example, on the way from where the river is flowing, a landslide occurs, so it will block the course, the way the river is flowing, then of course it is going to cause flooding. Falling of the trees can obstruct the flow of the river, correct? Construction activities, man-made factor could be construction activities in the river bed. Nowadays, apart from the land, away from the natural factors, people are now even going into construction activities near the river bed, because land availability is low and population is more. So the construction activities, they will also form flow obstruction and change in the river course. For example, giving you an example of construction activities, reclamation. When do you say reclamation of land? Okay. For example, if you talk about this Bandra reclamation, okay, the buildings there are very near to the water, correct? To the ocean water. Now, when do you say that is a reclamation land? Before construction, before any building that has been there, it was all covered with water. It was previously, the history of that area is, it was previously wholly covered with water. But then, in that place, construction activities took place, diverting or moving away the ocean water from there. So that we call it as a reclamation area. Reclamation area in the sense, it is that area where previously water used to be there. And now the water is moved from that particular area. I mean, the construction activities are carried out in that bed. Okay. So if you have this reclamation areas, of course, the capacity you are reducing. So if the construction activities occur in the river bed, of course, the obstruction to the river beds is happening, and that will lead to flooding. Okay. Then common floods in the main and tributary rivers. Okay. So why this cause happens? There is flash flood due to high discharge in the main river. Immediately for an instance, if there is high discharge in the main river, so it will cause flooding in the main and the tributary rivers. Okay, then man-made factors could be breaking of the bunds constructed on the tributary rivers for irrigation purpose. Now, breaking of bunds are also small obstructions that are created. Okay, so for diverting the water, if the velocity or you say if that water is to be used for irrigation purpose, that bunds would be broken. And once that bunds would be broken, it will be flooded with water. Okay, then poor natural drainage. If you don't have a proper drainage system, of course, it is going to lead to flood. So what happens, what leads to this poor natural drainage? Obstruction of the natural drainage by reducing the absorbing capacity of the soil. Now everywhere you see buildings, or what do you see is this, you don't see a soil area. You everywhere see paver blocks, footpaths, concreting done, okay? Even if you go outside your building, you're living in a society. If you go outside your building, as you step outside your building, is it what? It is soil below? Hardly people might be experiencing that. Otherwise, it is all covered with the paver blocks or the tiles or the concrete. Okay. So we hardly get to see soil availability freely. And this concrete or the paver blocks, they are not going to absorb the rainfall water. Okay, they are not going to absorb the rainfall water. What we require is the soil, but the soil the amount is reduced. So that is one of the man-made factors, that is high rate of urbanization pressure on the drainage system. Okay, that is one of the reason, and obstruction of the natural drainage by absorbing capacity of the soil. If at all soil in that particular area is such that, now that is natural phenomena. We cannot control the type of soil in a particular area. The type of soil in a particular area is such that the absorbing capacity is very low. So of course there will be no natural absorption and natural drainage. Correct? Then another cause of flood is cyclone. As you know, cyclone is one of the reasons which causes flood. So, and cyclone is caused by natural factors like high precipitation, okay? And of course, cyclone does not have any man-made factor responsible for it. It is mostly because of the high precipitation, changes in the water that leads to cyclone, okay? Then, another cause is retardation of the flow and backwater effect, okay? So, that cause is due to the natural factor like high runoff, topography and obstruction of the natural drainage, and man-made factor could be inadequate drainage capacity and urbanization in the low-lying areas. Now, what is this? Retardation of flow and backwater effect. Same way like we had seen obstruction to the flow, same is the retardation of the flow and backwater effect. If you obstruct the flow of a river in a particular area, there will be backwater flowing. The water flowing backwards. Okay. And that will cause this flood in a particular area where it is flowing back. Okay. So naturally also this backwater effect happens because of the topography or obstruction of the natural drainage. They happen. Now when you say Kerala, so there you say there are a lot of backwaters. So what is backwater actually? There are many where the rivers are actually meeting the sea water. And what happens, there is backwater flowing. Okay, which is all obviously because of the natural phenomena, some changes in the topography and all. Okay, but due to urbanization in the low-lying areas, that could be also the man-made factor for backwater effect. Then heavy rainfall. So heavy rainfall, naturally, of course, it occurs. And heavy rainfall happens, but due to decreasing vegetation cover and high urbanization, it leads to heavy runoff. If there would have been more vegetation cover, there would have been less urbanization. Much of the rainfall would be absorbed, naturally drained. Okay, so these are the certain causes and factors responsible for those causes. Okay, so here also you can see drainage, catchment size in the sense the holding of the water, catchment, the area which catches the water. Okay, so size of that catchment area, if it is reduced, it also causes flooding. Attempts at management, land use, catchment shape, meteorological condition, vegetative relief, geology, state of the ground, or antecedent conditions like flash flood and all, immediate if you have such condition where high rainfall is there. Okay. So, impacts of flood, you know it. That is human loss, property loss, affects the major roads, disruption of the air, train, bus services, spread of waterborne communicable diseases, communication breakdown, electricity supply cutoffs, economic and social disruption, increase in the air and water pollution. So all these are the effect of the flood. Now, you know, there are effect, I mean, water pollution and all is the reason. Increase in the air pollution also, it after the flood, you know, it causes unhygienic condition in that particular area. Unhygienic condition, unhygienic waste not properly managed, and because after the flood effect, because of this unhygienic condition, air pollution, odor release. Okay, so it is also an indirect impact. Then flood forecasting in the sense prediction, okay, anticipating prediction of the flood before they occur allows for precautions to be taken and people to be warned so that they can be prepared in advance for flooding conditions. So this is required as we also get the early signs, right? Whether there will be flooding, whether the heavy rainfall would be such that it might cause flooding. So forecasting, for example, if forecasting is done, farmers can remove animals from low-lying areas and utility services can put in place emergency provisions to reroute the services if needed. Emergency services can also make provisions to have enough resource available ahead of time to respond to emergencies as they occur. Okay, that example is given that how if forecasting is done, prediction is done properly, how people can take care to face that situation. Because flood is now uncontrollable. What at our level we can do is to minimize the impact of that flood. Then, in order to make the most accurate flood forecast for waterways, it is best to have long-time series of historical data that relates stream flow to measure the past rainfall events. So flood forecast actually is done with all the way the capacity of the streams has reduced, the way the rainfall pattern is in that particular area. Then radar, radio detection and ranging estimates, rainfall and general weather forecasting techniques are also important components of good flood forecasting. Radar is is used in the meteorological department. So it also helps in prediction of the rainfall. Then, few of the measures of flood control. Like I said, you cannot prevent. You can control. You can minimize the effect. Okay. So, in many countries around the world, waterways prone to floods are often carefully managed. Defenses such as levees, bunds, reservoirs, weirs are used to prevent the waterways from overflowing their banks. Now, see here. Suppose this is a river, this part, and this is not a natural bank that is created. The sides, they are not the natural ones that are created. Correct? These are called the levees. Bunds are smaller than the levees. They are the obstructions, sorry, the obstruction walls, okay, that are created to divert that water or to increase the height of that bank. Okay, so you can see here. So those are created that even if the water level rises, it won't flood the land. Okay, so reservoirs, you know, those are to store the water. The weirs, mostly where a dam, the weirs and near the dam, when the velocity of the water is high, the weirs, that is small height structures, are created so that in between, when there is obstruction to the flow of the water, the velocity of the water would be reduced. Okay, then in riparian zone in the sense where ripe, it has come from the word ripe, riparian zone in the sense the zone or the area on the land where could easily stream erosion control measures can slow down or reverse. Then flood control see you when you have this riparian zone. Okay, so vegetation cover could help in controlling the flood. Then flood dams can be built and maintained over time to run of the flood as well. Okay, so dam, you know, for storing the water could be built properly to and could maintain properly so that the severity of the flood could be reduced. Then national perspective, floods in India. Floods cause damage to houses, industries, public utilities, property, etc., causing huge economic losses apart from loss of lives. So it is not possible to control the flood disaster totally, but by adopting suitable structural and non-structural measures, flood damages can be minimized. As I already told you, you cannot prevent or control it completely, but you can try your level best to manage it and to decrease the damage caused by it. Okay, so the some structural and non-structural measures are given. That is, the concept is the structural measures, following the structural measures, the concept behind that is control over the hazard, that is the flood, and protection of the human settlement. Same way, the non-structural measures are taken care with the concept that hazard mitigation or avoidance could be done and adjustment of the human activities. Okay. So some structural measures in case of flooding are the sea walls, levees, structure of the dams, breakwater, just now what we had seen. Okay, so those are structural measures, correct? So then pumps, channel improvements, diversions and groins, strengthening buildings through building codes, building shelters. So those are structurally made measures. Non-structural measures could be land use management by planning tools, comprehensive plan, zoning, ordinance and incentives, proper land use management. When you know which are the flood prone areas, and in that flood prone areas also, which area is more prone to flooding and which area is less prone to flooding, so you can manage the land use that way. Infrastructure policy, insurance, awareness, that is education, information dissemination and partnership, protect natural areas like the vegetation cover, basically maritime forest in the sense the forest near the marine areas, wetland, dunes, risk reduction and preparedness policies. Okay, those are certain non-structural measures in order to deal with the flood. So here you can see the flood prone areas of our country. So I'll show you this map. So if you could see here, the state is given and million hectare, that is that million hectare of land is prone to flood. Okay, so and wherever there is green, this dark green color, the whole that area is prone to flood. Okay, so you can see this Gujarat, Rajasthan, Haryana, Delhi, Uttar Pradesh, Orissa, Andhra Pradesh, Kerala, okay, West Bengal, Assam, all these are the flood prone areas and the million hectare area is also given. Okay, Then, by a spy diagram also, it is shown that which areas are prone to flood. So, if you talk about Uttar Pradesh, it is 21.9% of the area is more prone to the flood. Bihar, it is 12.71. Assam, 9.4. West Bengal, 7.9. Orissa, 4.18%, and other state, that is 43.9. Talking about few of the important floods that has happened, major disasters that has happened in our country. 2012 Brahmaputra floods. This was another sorrow caused to Assam in recent years. In July 2012, Brahmaputra and its tributaries showed its wrath, and the main area which was affected, including the Kaziranga National Park, a park which is a natural habitat for rhinos. It caused a death of around 540 animals, including 13 rhinos. And the main reason behind this calamity is a deforestation in the area of passing by of Brahmaputra. So that is a man-made factor responsible for this type of disaster, deforestation near the Brahmaputra. Okay, so then 2010 Ladakh floods. It was 6th August 2010 when the series of natural disasters started to take place in Ladakh, a regional part of Jammu Kashmir. It was accompanied with cloudburst. Okay, cloudburst, which happens when there is heavy rainfall, debris flows, flash floods from the Himalayan, and the casualty was less than 300. Causality or casualty, what you say, is less than 300. That means the people affected. But a great loss to property was reported. Area of Leh was also affected, and it caused a total loss of around 133 crores. Then 2005 Maharashtra flood. You know this. This was the major and most devastating disaster occurring in Maharashtra, mainly engulfing the areas of Mumbai, Chipalonkhed, Kalyan, Ratnagiri, and Raigarh. The main problem arose with the people on the road, and which caused a traffic jam, and with it came the loss of people. A total of around 5,000 people were reported for the death toll. The date of 26 July 2005 has been marked as one of the black day in the history of Mumbai. Then 2004 Bihar flood. The Mumbai flood, that we will see a video on it, the 26 July flood. Okay, so 2004 Bihar flood, being considered as a flood prone area, Bihar is again in the list because of the 2004 flood which it suffered. It was stated that around total 883 people lost their lives and more than 3,000 animals were killed. Rivers, primarily the Gada, Kosi, Mahananda, Bagmati, Budhi, had already crossed the red mark. Red mark in the sense the full level, full high flood level mark. Okay, HFL, what you say. It has already crossed the red mark. While on the other hand, Ganga, first time in its history, crossed the red mark in the Farakka barrage. Now, just now we had seen some structural and non-structural measures. That is, when you talk about structural measures, you can see here both are the structural measures. Embankment is dams and reservoirs, natural detention basin, detention in the sense holding basin, channel improvement, drainage improvement, diversion of the flood water. These are the structural measures. And certain non-structural measures, that is flood plain zoning and flood proofing, flood preparedness and community level awareness, flood forecasting and early warning system, afforestation, public relief, flood insurance, all these are the non-structural measures to control the flood. Flood management, the approach is flood cannot be absolutely controlled. Flood can only be managed to reduce the flood losses and the impact caused by it. Increased vulnerability, what are the causes? Indiscriminate encroachment. Now you know the flood-prone areas, but apart from that flood-prone areas, many areas are becoming more vulnerable to flood. Why? What are the causes? Indiscriminate encroachment. Now you know urbanization, encroachment of the land, increasing economic and development activities in the flood plains. If you know that particular area is in flood plain, but still increasing developing and economic and developmental activities, lack of regulation, inadequate drainage system, there is no proper drainage of that water, inadequate maintenance, lack of disaster preparedness. So these are the reasons which are causing increasing the vulnerability. Okay, now this is a small simple image just to show you floodplain zoning. I mean, see here the blue line, this is a normal channel. Okay, this is not a road, channel, that is some river water. Okay, and when you know you are the land is near a river water, of course you know that particular area is more prone to flood. So you can see this dark blue color that comes under frequent flood zone. Okay, dark blue. Then comes your second. See here, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, how the zoning is done. And after that flood prone zone, okay, that is the frequent flood zone. Next is your second part. Don't look over what image is given here, university factory and all those things. Don't look over that now. First, see here, this is a normal channel. That is flow of water is also given. Near that channel of river, say, frequent flood area shown with the dark blue color. Then the next area beyond that is the flood once in 25 years. So we would say it is less prone area or moderate prone area, we would say. Okay, so flood once in 25 years. And this green part, that is flood once in 100 years, that is very less prone area to flood. Now, when you divide a particular land into such zones, okay, when you know there is a river channel or some channel of water, and when you are divided the area in such way that near to the river, those particular kilometer area will be in the frequent flood zone. The next area would be in the flood once in 25 years, and the other areas, that is flood once in 100 years, that is less flood prone area. If the land is divided, if the floodplain zones are divided such way, now you can then divide the or decide on the land use. So now you know when the area which is in dark blue color, frequent flood area, there of course I don't have to do some economic activities because flood might, of course, frequent flood occurs in that area. So what happens? The park part, the vegetation cover will be more in that particular area. Okay, then flood once in 25 years. So of course some university, some government offices, okay, residential areas could be in between that. Flood once in 100 years. Now we want such structures which should never be or we should be least affected by the flood. So would that important structures would be water supply, correct? The water supply system that should never be in the flood prone area, otherwise the whole system will shut down and people won't get the water supply. Okay, so it should never be in the flood prone area. So that is why it is shown in the green. Hospitals are very important structures already. It is for dealing with the patients, so it should not be near the flood prone area. Powerhouse, no, never. Powerhouse where electricity is generated, it should never be in the flood prone area. And certain factories, they should also not be, otherwise they are going to cause a lot of economic loss and lead to some indirect disaster. Okay, so that should also never be in the flood prone area, the factories. So this way, when the land is divided into different zone, and then a proper land use could be done. Then see, the same thing is shown here. That is, when you have a river channel, you have a zone called the prohibitive, then you have restrictive, and then you have a warning zone shown with these three colors: dark blue, this cream color, and the green color. Correct? Prohibitive, restrictive, and warning. This way, the land is divided. Flood management could be done by using remote sensing and GIS. So in the further module, we will be seeing how softwares like remote sensing GIS help in prediction of the flood, or helps in making of this what do you say, the map, whatever map we see, the flood prone area map or earthquake prone area or any disaster prone area map that we see, all those maps are prepared using this GIS and remote sensing, because those maps are with scale. It's not just like something that is made on the paint. Such maps which are made with scale, giving you a proper area for measurement, so those are done with the help of softwares. Research and development in this flood management will be very helpful. Weather and rainfall forecasting, then flood modeling, okay, then capacity building, international cooperation. So all this will help in flood management, correct? So now this is all about the flood. Now just I told you that I will be showing you a video on the reason behind flooding in our area frequently. So just give me a second.
On 2nd July, Mumbai came to a standstill. Exceptionally heavy rains lashed at the country's financial capital. Roads were flooded, trains stopped working, and 31 people died after a wall collapsed in Malad. This was the highest rainfall the city recorded in one day in the last decade. But this isn't the first time that Mumbai has received heavy rains, and this won't be the last.
With two full monsoon months to go,
Mumbai may very well find itself in the same situation again this year, and next year, and the next. Here's why. Mumbai is a city by the coast, surrounded by the sea on three sides, and has always recorded very heavy rainfall. During one of the worst floods on July 26, 2005, the city recorded 944 millimeters of rain in just 24 hours. This was the highest rainfall recorded in a single day. Studies have shown that climate change and rising temperatures in the Arabian Sea, which lines Mumbai, has increased instances of extreme rainfall over the years. So why does Mumbai flood every year? It's not just poor infrastructure. The city's geographical composition, the impact of climate change, shoddy planning, administrative and political negligence, and a constant race of the city's infrastructure to play catch-up all play major factors. Mumbai was built by reclaiming land from the sea, low-lying wetlands, marshlands, rivers and creeks.
Seven islands were joined more than 300 years ago to form a trading post for the East India Company, planting the seeds of a very extraordinary future.
There was also ample reclamation within the city, even from wetlands and mudflats, all of which are low-lying areas. Not all of it was scientific or properly done. So this combination of an intense downpour and naturally low-lying areas is why there is such flooding. Add a high tide to the mix and things get dangerous. Excess flood water cannot be discharged in the sea during a high tide. Reclaiming land for development and encroachments has altered the coastline, changed sea level and tidal currents, and eroded beaches. The city's rivers and creeks have gotten narrower and shallower, increasing the risk of flooding. Take Mumbai's infamous Mithi River. It passes through congested residential areas which let out raw sewage in the river and litter it with garbage. The river is 17.8 kilometers in length and has an average width of about 10 meters. The average depth of sludge thrown into the river is 1 meter. That's 15,000 truckloads of sludge. In 2005, when the city was hit by a torrential downpour, the river was one of the main reasons of flooding. It restricted flood due to encroachments on both banks. Erratic development has depleted Mumbai's vegetation cover. The increase in concrete cover is a major reason for waterlogging. The excessive use of concrete increases the burden on the man-made drainage system, which remains forever inadequate given the pace of growth in the city's built-up area. A study by the Indian Institute of Sciences in Bangalore says that 94% of Mumbai has been concretized in the past 4 decades, swallowing up the city's green lungs and holding ponds. Mumbai has lost 60% of its vegetation and 65% of its water bodies in the process. There are three types of flooding that Mumbai really faces, and sometimes it's a combination of all three. One is localized isolated flooding due to poor drainage caused by encroachments and blockages. The second type is flooding due to overflows from the Mithi River, the largest catchment area and a source of natural draining for suburbs. And third, it's flooding due to a combination of high river flows and high tide. Mumbai's drainage system is ages old. There is a 525-kilometer network of underground drains and laterals in the island city, most dating back to the British rule, and about 2,000 kilometers of roadside surface drains, 186 outfalls, and more than 30,000 water entrances. So during a heavy rainfall like the one on 2nd July, the city received nearly 80 millimeters of rain in a single hour. The drainage system can only pump out water at 25 millimeters per hour at low tide. Today, at most places, at least in theory, these drains have the capacity of 50 millimeters per hour. With silt and sludge in drains and outfalls, water that should have been flowing out into the sea or the city's rivers is blocked and drains slower. Excess water flows back up through these drainage systems during a high tide, resulting in flooding. After the July 2005 deluge, the BMC took up the Brihanmumbai Storm Water Disposal System, a project planned to overhaul Mumbai's water drainage system. It sought to enhance the city's drainage systems to a capacity of 50 millimeters per hour and have better flood water pumping stations. But bureaucratic red tape, land acquisition woes, and difficulties in removing encroachments that often have political patronage has ensured that the project is incomplete even after 14 years. So far, the BMC has spent a little over 2,000 crore rupees and been able to complete only 16 of the 20 works identified in the first phase of the project and 11 of the 38 works earmarked for the second phase. Projects involving rejuvenating Mumbai's polluted rivers Mithid, Dahisar, Boisar and Oshiwara have dragged on. What happened on 2nd July can very well happen again this season or the next season until Mumbai learns its larger planning lessons.